Right. Hey, everybody, it's your girl Nisha, aka Nisha the Voice, live with Industry Conversations 101. I have with me the infamous father MC on with me tonight. I am so excited. It's an honor to have you here with me tonight talking about what you got going on and also kind of reminiscing a little bit. I just want to tell you I'm a huge fan. I loved Treat 'Em Like You Want to Be Treated. I love I'll Do For You, and I also love Everything's Gonna Be All Right. So those were like those three top singles from you that I love. I'm an 80s baby, so I know a lot about your music. And I can remember, and I think a lot of people may not remember this, but you know, I remember seeing the video where you was the first to introduce us to Mary, because Mary was in the video. And then I remember seeing Jodeci. That was the very first time we saw Jodeci, because those that don't know, that was the record in which you saw Casey and Devontae Swing going at it with the baby, yeah, baby. I was like, okay. Yeah, so it was, you know, for me, and like I said, I always loved your music, because at that time, the 90s was a great time for music. It was a great time because everybody was having fun at that time. Music made sense. Right. Not saying that it don't make sense now, but music made sense. And you talked about love. You talked about real stuff that people can relate to. And I loved your music because it wasn't the type of rap that was degrading women. It was the type of music that where women like to hear. Women would actually be on the dance floor jamming to your records, you know? Yeah. And I applaud you for that, because you stay true to who you were. And you know, also basically of being on the infamous Uptown Records, which those that not know, I think it was the Motown of the 90s, because they had a great roster of artists. You know what I mean? Crazy. Yeah. So, you know, speaking on that, I just want to know, at that time, how was it for you? Because you were in the era of the New Jack Swing, you know, and also where hip hop was, you know, still evolving. So tell me about that time. What was it like being on, you know, Uptown Records and so forth?
Well, being on Uptown Records, it was kind of crazy, because Uptown was like, it wasn't even to me like a record label. I think it was like a college dorm, you know, but everybody worked and everybody knew that they had a mission to break records. And that was the thing. Like you hit it on the nail when you said nail and tooth, when you said Motown. We were the Motown of the 90s. Right. And we were the soundtrack of people's lives. Like, you know, like the music was heartfelt, and we tried to make albums that were just crazy, you know. We didn't try to go the route of a one single, two single, you out deal. We was trying to just do it.
Right. You know? Definitely. I mean, and that was a time where people made albums, you know, where you sat back and you waited for artists to, you know, to come out with something. It was like you were waiting for your album, or waiting for Jodeci's album, waiting for Mary's album to, you know, to pop off. So it was more so for me. It was great to sit back and hear great bodies of work, and people tell stories. You know what I mean?
Right,
like
right.
You don't hear it right now in the hip hop that, you know, that we have up right now, but people tell stories. They told stories about relationships. They told stories about the struggle of what they were going through in order to make it in the business, you know? So definitely, you know, I appreciated that time. And then, you know, now that we're talking about Uptown, I want to talk a little bit about your work with the late Andre Harrell, who, you know, definitely is, you know, greatly missed. I had the opportunity to meet him several years ago. And okay. The thing was that Andre was so full of life when you met him. It was always, you know, the infamous laugh.
You know? I was just telling somebody that last night on an interview, his laugh was crazy.
Yeah. And, you know, it was, for me, you know, I think for people, he had this vision of what he wanted Uptown to be. And I want to talk from your perspective of what was it like working with Andre?
Well, working with Andre, we had like, well, me personally, I had like a brother relationship with Dre. Like, I knew his position. I knew he was the boss. I knew what he said went, you know what I mean? But then outside of that, Dre was the funniest character. He was a character. He was the funniest guy on earth. Like, dude, I mean, we would crack jokes on people in front of us, and me and him would know it. And then he just... He just started laughing, and he put his head down and go like this. And, like, it's crazy. I remember at the office, like, when the record cut, when the executives and the other executives was there. And I'm an artist at this point, so I don't really care about what's going on. I'm just, when somebody's in trouble, I'm egging it on. So, you know, and Andre just look and I mean, you have to, Andre was crazy, man. But he used to do stuff on impulse. Like, we were in Cali. We were about to shoot the One Night Stand. No, we were about to shoot Affection on my second album. And he had the film crew. He had everybody there. And we in L.A. I'm in MCA building because that was our parent company, MCA.
Right,
and he's sitting in the office on like 30th floor or something, looking out the window. And I walk in the office, I'm like, yo, Dre, what's up? You good? And he said, yeah. He said, we not shooting Affection. I'm like, we not shooting Affection. We got everybody here from New York. I mean, even the talent was from New York. They brought the talent out here and everything. And he's like, we not doing that. We shooting One Night Stand. I'm packing. I'm telling everybody, pack up. We going home.
Wow.
It was crazy. And everybody looked. We went home. But it wasn't really a bad thing because I love that he switched the single, like, on impulse. You know what I mean? And and it worked. And it worked. That was the thing. It worked. So, you know, as far as, like, if Dre felt music, if he felt your music, he'd do this, like, funny face, squinch up, and start doing his little head bop, drop his head, and you knew you had something. But if he did, like, one of these, like, it's over. It's over.
Yeah.
Over.
Yeah.
So, I mean, Dre was just something else, man. I mean, a friend. I remember me and him used to go to the clubs and when Father MC, when they had a party for me, and I'll never forget, he called me one night, and I had bought a house in Long Island, and he's like, I said, where you at? He's like, yo, I'm in the city. Yo, you walk in here, you like Michael Jackson. I said, all right, I'm getting up. I'm trying to throw stuff on while you on the phone. And I'm like, I'm on my way. I get there, and it was crazy. It was crazy. I mean, Dre was the life of the party. And anywhere, anywhere you went to, you know.
Yeah definitely. It's amazing. You know, so much that he has brought to the industry, and you know, all so many stories. And I know, you know, as we're speaking up on Uptown, I know that the documentary will soon be, you know, coming on at BET. So that's something I think that everybody is pretty much waiting on, for the story to finally be told about Uptown Records, you know. And there's so many rumors about what transpired, what went on. And I think what people, especially in media, when people talk about the bad stuff, they don't really elaborate on the good things that actually came from that label. You know, it's more so of focusing on the good things, the good music that, you know, that we had, you know, from that label within itself. I mean, you had a roster, like I keep saying, a roster of great talent that, you know, came from Uptown, you know. And you see so many documentaries, you know, the unsungs of some of the artists that have been on Uptown Records, and they talk about the fun, everything that, you know, that transpired with being on that label. So, you know, with you, like I said, it was a fun time. Like, we used to make up dance moves to your record, you know?
Crazy.
Yeah. Crazy. So, you know, it was a good time, you know? And, you know, I know whatsoever that, you know, while you was making, you know, making your debut at that time, I want to talk about your first album, Father's Day. That's a title within itself. You know, it's a classic album, but I want to talk about, I understand, like, you know, Father MC, but where did that come from? It was it just like, you know, your thought process of, it's my arrival, or it was it just something that you just thought up off the dome to name it?
No, no. To be honest with you, quite frank, it was Andre's
idea. Wow. Okay.
I had some whole other stuff going on. And Dre's like, the name of your album, Money, is called Father's Day. It's called Father's Day. He said it just like that. And I was like, okay, that works. You know, it made sense. So it worked. So at the end of the day, when we dropped it, and then when we did the album covers and everything, and he was just like, yeah, I'm going with Father's Day. I'm going with Father's Day. So I was, it was a, like the train was going. The train was going. Like once, that's what took me so long to drop the album. Because right. Once they dropped Treat Them Like You Want to Be Treated, it like almost a year, I was on the road, like immediately on the road. And we didn't know the success that Treat Them was. I bought my mom's a house on Treat Them Like You Want to Be Treated. One
that
single.
That song was huge. That was crazy. Song was huge. I mean,
and we had
huge.
Like 30, 40, 50 remixes. So
yeah.
When Dre was like, yo, you know, I couldn't do anything because I'm on, you know, I'm on the road over here. MCA right. got me over here. I see them are now getting me spot dates. So it was mad. And then they trying to stick me in studios across the country to finish right. this album. It was nuts. Yeah. It was nuts. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And then, you know, even with Treat Them Like They Want to Be Treated, the Do For You video, like, it, and I'm gonna tell you, like, it, the white background reminds me so much of Bobby Brown, the Bobby Brown video.
And actually, it was we stole it. We said
really said, okay, so I had it yeah, right there.
You had it right. It's crazy because when we did it, I was like, Dre was just like, we're taking it. So what? We're taking it. And it was, and the crazy part is when I met Bobby, it was so funny because Bobby, I was on tour. And my tour bus had like 3 or 4 days to get to the next place, right? So
right.
Hammer was in concert in New York. So okay. My manager said, yo, I'm gonna fly you into New York and you catch back up with your tour bus. So I said, cool. I get into Madison Square Garden. I'm walking down and Bobby is sitting right. This is the first time we ever meet. Bobby's sitting right down, just looking at me and smiling. And I was like, okay. And then he made room for me to come up there, and we fooled ever since. Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm telling you, like, when I saw it, because that was like, you know, Mary singing, and then you going on, and I was like, wow, I was like, that's dope. And then it was like, it reminds you of the Every Little Step video, and I was like, wow, I was like, that's nice. And then, you know, like I said, when you get the glimpse of Mary, and you hear Mary on the hook, and it was just, it was such a good vibe. Like I said, it was, when we would hear the song, like I keep saying, like, it was that type of music where you just get up and you want to dance when you hear it. Soon as right. the beat drop, boom, like you want to dance. And at that time, like I said, it was a point in time where you've loved to hear hip hop that just made you want to groove and that talked about realistic stuff. You know what I mean? So
yes.
and it's, you know, we have to get back to that. I mean, some type of way we have to get back to that. And, you know, I want to drift a little bit to talk about hip hop now, you know, talk about the now. I know that you have so much going on as of right now. And, you know, there's so much going on in the world. And I know you've got so many good projects that's going on, especially the new Black Disney album that you're working on. So tell me about that. Where is Father MC right now with 2021?
Man, being safe from COVID, first of all. You know, this COVID thing is crazy. I wish everybody, you know, stay safe and everything. But like you said, we got the Uptown 3-part miniseries coming on BET. They're trying to wrap that up, you know. We have a thing called Uptown Beyond, which is okay. our podcast. You know, me and the president, Jimmy Jenkins and Janon Parker. We got together and we interviewed everyone from all of the singers on Uptown, MCA, mm-hmm. that Andre Harrell has something to do with. Then the beyond part is we interview, you know, the movie stars, television stars, because a lot of people don't realize, like, Andre was more than music. He had New York Undercover. That was Uptown.
Right.
You know, he had right. the movie Honey, which was his business partner, Alonzo Brown. So we had that, all of that. And then now we stepped into interviewing like we showing you scenes and flicks and everything with Demi Moore, like just a lot of those like real big movie stars and television stars, the show who Dre really intertwined with, did business with. He was with Dick Wolf, was, you know, a business partner of his in some ventures. And it was just crazy. And that's what made me say, let me do this album and drop Black Disney. Let me start making Black Disney. And in the making of Black Disney, it just became more serious because it was just a thought. You know, I liked the name. I came up with it. I liked the name Black Disney. So I said, yeah, you know what? Let me start making the album. I started working on the album and it started getting a lot of action from a lot of people around the world. So I was like, okay. So I remember Jannard Parker told me, he said, yo, why don't you make the album and drop it around the same time the movie and everything else comes out and take advantage? And I was like, yo, you know what? Let's get it in. I'm going to do it. Definitely. And then we start flying out to Atlanta. I've been to Atlanta so much in the last 5 to 6 months. Like every other week in the last 3 months, every other week, literally going to Atlanta, because that was considered our base.
Okay.
You know, so all of us would meet and it was New York, Atlanta, and LA.
Okay.
And we would meet. Yeah, and I'm in LA now. So we would meet here. We would meet in Atlanta majority of the times because it was a halfway point for all of us. And New York. And we were shooting. We had hotel suites and we had the camera crew there. It was nuts. It was nuts. It was crazy.
Well, you know, as I stated, I'm very excited to see exactly, you know, what is in this three-piece documentary. And I know it's going to be great. I know everyone is excited to finally, you know, see it come to life, you know, and I know you are as well, to see it comes to life. So what can we expect on the Black Disney album? Like, I know it's going to be like your flavor.
It's going to be moving. The music's going to be moving everybody. You know, I still got some traditional Father MC stuff on it. And then I got some more of, I got something for everybody. Awesome. It's crazy.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And I can't wait to hear it. And then there was one thing that I want everybody to know, that you do have a new, you know, show coming up called Fathers Knows Best. So tell us about that.
Well, it was Father Knows Best, but it's now the Father of Love.
Oh, okay, cool.
So basically, they're trying to ink it now where it's like the Flavor of Love, but the Father of Love. And that's what they're trying to do. It's in the works right now, but it's a good look, though.
Yeah, oh, definitely, definitely. I will be watching because I want to see exactly what goes down on that.
It's crazy. So. It's going to be crazy. Crazy.
Definitely. And, you know, and I know we have a lot of individuals that are watching tonight on Instagram and, you know, also that's on Facebook. And, you know, you have a lot of inspiring rappers or MCs. What advice would you actually give them, you know, on your journey, which, you know, you've been on a long journey within this hip hop game and see how hip hop have evolved all over the years? What would be, you know, your advice to them, you know, coming into this business?
And first of all, just keep your faith in God. Mm-hmm. Keep your faith in God. That's straight up number one. Number two is stay in the studio. Stay in the studio and bake, especially right now because it's COVID. So you want to be in the studio as much as you can because that's your lotto store. That's your lotto store. One hit can make your whole life change in 10 seconds. Yes. So stay in there and you know, be original, come original. If you know, I hear a lot of cats that sound the same now. It's like when we were out, we had to get creative. We had to, you know, enunciate like they used to always tell us in the studio. Yeah, but now, I mean, and it's today's music, so I'm not mad at it. You know what I'm saying? It's just that, you know, try to be original. Try to be original and just stay on your grind. And it's not easy. It's not easy. Y'all guys got it a little easier because the internet. We didn't have the internet back then. So we had to get on them trains and buses and walk in the snow to try to do what we had to do. Y'all got the internet, and y'all got all this email stuff jumping off. So, you know, and have fun with it.
Yeah, definitely. And you know, and to your point, like I heard a lot about the stories of walking in the snow, of a lot of blood, sweat, and tears that was placed into, you know, making it, you know? And now you have the new age of hip hop that has evolved, that does have social media. Social media has really taken over the new development of artists, making artists.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think some of the content, like you said, that is out right now. Yes, a lot of, you know, artists do sound the same. And you're absolutely right. Back then, everybody had to be creative. Everybody could sound the same. You couldn't get a deal if you sound like someone else.
Facts.
You really had to be different, and you had to stand out from others. And I think now it's more so, and I remember Beyonce did an interview and she spoke about it. She was like, nobody's like really interested in really making making albums anymore. Everybody just want to make singles. So where's the longevity? Where is the, you know, where's the hard work that goes into it, that kind of the where you make a great body of work to where
the artists gotta realize, you know, you don't get paid on a single if you're looking to get paid from a record company.
Right.
You know, you don't get paid on a single because a single's 99 cents. Now, you can get paid off of a single by touring everywhere around or getting an endorsement, getting endorsed, but getting paid from a record company on a single is not heard of, you know? Mm-hmm. It's just not gonna happen. Throw your body of work out there and let them know, like, this is me, express yourself, you know?
Right, exactly. And I think that's the part of the business that a lot of artists miss, that part of what you just stated. A lot of artists think that coming into this business, you can make one single and you get paid off that single, but there's other blood, sweat, and tears that goes off of it where you actually see the money, where you see the revenue. There's a lot that goes into it. You have to really know your royalties. You have to know, make sure that your percentages are straight, your split sheets are right. So those type of things, a lot of artists miss that part of it. And it's, I think when they look on TV and they see the glitz and glamour, and it's really not the glitz and glamour. It's really a lot of blood, sweat, and tears to get
it's
to
work. These artists. It's work.
It's work.
It's glitz and glamour to the people that are watching the aftermath.
Right.
But to get to the aftermath, you have to put in that work regardless. That's
exactly.
Work. Yeah.
Exactly. Crazy. Definitely. It was a pleasure talking to you tonight. I don't want to hold you too long, but before we get out of here, tell us your Instagram, your social media, where everyone that's watching, where they can, you know, reach you.
You can reach me at on Instagram. Everything's tied into my Instagram, Twitter, the Facebook is at The Real Father MC. So it's just at The Real Father MC. Y'all could check me out. And I do connect with people and write back and do all of that. So hit me up and let's see what to do. And thank you for having me too.
Oh, thank you. You know, like I said, it was a pleasure of actually to sit here, to talk with you tonight. Like I told you, I'm a fan. I've been a fan forever since I've heard your first single. So it thank was, you. When thank I you. When I found out you was coming on the show, it was like, hey, we got a real one. We got a rapper. We got an MC. on tonight. So, you know, it's an honor to have you on, and I want to thank you again for taking the opportunity to sit with me and talk with me. I know you are busy. You got so much things going on. I wish you so much best, so much luck for
this year. Thank you. Thank you so much.
And I know I'm excited to see the Uptown documentary. I'm excited to see all your projects come to fruition. And I know everybody that's watching tonight is excited to see, you know, that, you know, we all will get to see you and see you flourish in 2021. So I'm excited. Thank you again for coming on the Industry Conversations 1-on-1.
No doubt. Anytime. And y'all be careful out there too. All right.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
All right. Beautiful.
All right.
Bye-bye.
All right, you guys, this is your girl, Nisha, a.k.a. Nisha the Voice, signing out for Industry Conversations 101. Shouts out to Press Magazine for sponsoring Industry Conversations 101. Good night, y'all.